Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another exciting Turbo Diplomacy matchup. This time, we're going to be playing on the Middle East. Here we have the Empire of Persia, I suppose. Up here, probably a little bit of Iraq, Mesopotamia, Saudi Arabia, and then Egypt over here. And I think this is still Egypt, although I'm not sure with my geography so much. But yeah, it's the Middle East. Home to a lot of Age of Empires civilizations, a lot of ancient civilizations. The first few of the early civilizations, the Babylons, the Mesopotamian Empire, all started, of course, in the Middle East. So yeah, it's going to be an exciting map. Let's introduce the players. We have Street Pete. He is playing as the Persians. Now, these civs were choose civilizations with lowest ELO choosing first. So let's go ahead and start with the lowest ELO on this map, which I believe was development. Development is 1600. He has chosen to play as the Byzantines. You cannot choose two of the same civilization, so he gets the first pick of whatever he wants. He chose Byzantines. The second player would be Leo EK, I believe. Also 1600-ish, playing as the Byzantines. So Byzantines straight off the board right away. That was one of the first civilizations to go away. We'll talk about their civilization a little bit. Next we have Sean, who decided to pick the Berbers. Sean is 1700 level. So once Byzantines are off the board, Berbers are next. These are all Middle Eastern civs, of course. After Sean, I believe we had Toplo. Toplo is about 1700-ish. Picking the Persians. The Persians have probably the best cavalry, pound for pound at least, out of all these civilizations. And they get the War Elephant later on, too. So they'll definitely be a force in the Imperial Age. Then we go to some more of the more experienced players. We have Street Pete AOC. He is 1900 level. He's playing as the Persians. So Persians are off the board. We have Not Tyrant, Not the Viper playing as the Turks. So he's chosen to play as the Turks. He had a few options there. He had the choice between the Turks, the Persians, and the Saracens. And he's chosen the Turks. Sorry, the Turks, the Berbers, or the Saracens. The Persians was off. He's chosen the Turks out of those civilizations, so he'll be the only Turkish player here. And then the last player to choose a civilization was Pau, playing as the Saracens. So the Saracens are going to be one of the only civilizations where it's the last one picked. Now, take a little bit closer look at the map. This is Turbo Diplomacy, of course. The game speed is ultra fast. Not only are we playing where the villagers build faster, they collect resources faster, researchers are research faster, but also the game speed is on fast. So this is going to get started really quickly, and this is going to be diplomacy, so players will be making and breaking alliances, and it'll be very hard to follow. If you haven't seen my previous Turbo Diplomacy matches, you'll know that the player to win the game is not necessarily the most skilled player. It's also important that you're able to make alliances, because alliances will help you get by, help you eliminate other players one at a time, till eventually you could turn on your allies. But yeah, we'll see how the players do that. Before we take a look at the civ matchups, I do want to check where the players are as far as maybe location, whether they have access to fish, or also what kind of alliances they have. So let's go player by player, as players start to reach the feudal age. No action happening at the stage, just players building up. So over on the coast, we have Not Tyrant, Not the Viper. He's the Turkish player. Let's go to his point of view. Where is Not Tyrant, Not the Viper? Here he is. Now, I'm not sure if this works, but he is currently only allied with Toplo. So he's got only a single ally this game. So I think he's going to want to hold on to that pretty much. What I like to do in diplomacy is ally with everybody, and whoever will accept me, you know, that would be great. If everyone accepts me, that's great. Then I can, play my cards accordingly. But definitely send out all those friend requests early. All those alliances. And try to keep them as the game goes on. So Not Tyrant, he's only got one ally, but he does have access to a lot of nice fish. Look at all the fish that he could potentially have in this sea. This is, what, the Black Sea? No, it's not the Black Sea. It's the... I don't know what sea it is. I don't even know why I attempt to name it. So he's going to have a good economy. Let's check development now. Development is our 1600 level player playing as the Byzantines. Let's see who he's allied with. He is currently allied with Sean, Toplo, and Pau. So these three guys here, pretty easy to recognize. these three guys in Saudi Arabia, just not Leo, though. Leo is his enemy. So perhaps Toplo... Not Tyrant's also his enemy. So perhaps maybe we have a bottom versus top here, or at least that's what development would like, if he wants to stay in this game. He's also got some nice fishy. Not as nice as Not Tyrant, though. Not Tyrant's got fish for days, and Not Tyrant's also got a fire galley. So he's going to go right up against development. We'll have to see how that shakes out a little bit later on. Leo EK, right in the middle of the map. Leo is allied with Not Tyrant, Not the Viper, Toplo, and that's it, just those two guys, Not Tyrant and Toplo. So these guys on the top side. So interesting, maybe we'll have, again, another reason to think we'll have a top versus bottom here in Saudi Arabia. Let's check Pow. Pow is allied with Sean, Toplo, and Development. So Sean is over here in the bottom. We haven't seen a lot of Sean's recently, so far with these alliances. Toplo and Development. So it looks like these guys are pretty tight. These guys are pretty in consensus as to who they're allying. Development, Toplo, and Pal. That's good. Let's check Sean. Sean is allied with Pow, Development, and Toplo. So Pow, purple. Development over here, and Toplo. Where's Toplo? And Toplo. I like Sean's position. I mean, he's stuck in a corner. He's got lots of resources here. Normally there would be a player that spawns here, but since we're doing seven players, there isn't one. So he's got a lot of space to expand. He's got fishing. And his three closest players are all his allies. So that's nice diplomacy from Sean. Has Street Pete done the same thing? Street Pete is allied with Toplo and Pow. So Toplo, and where's Pow? Pow is over here, so no. Street Pete's going to have to compete with Leo EK and Not Tyrant, Not the Viper. So as far as diplomacy advantage, I would give the diplomacy advantage to Sean. We have a team kind of in the bottom side. They're pretty unanimous. We have a team on the top side. That is yet to be determined as this game shakes out. Who will Toplo's alliance belong to? Will it belong to the bottom team or the top team in Saudi Arabia? That has yet to be seen. Looks like Development has decided to defend with a few of his Byzantine fire ships. He'll have a good time on the water. And the Turks don't get any water bonuses, so that's good for his civilization. Most of the players are booming. We have a bit of a palisade wall here from Street Pete. I don't think it's really necessary. I would have walled the shallows. And most of the players are booming. Now, the civilization with the clear best boom in this game is going to be the Persians. They get extra starting resources, and their town centers work faster, and they get all their technologies. The only civilization that also gets an economy bonus is going to be the Turks, but that's a gold bonus, and eventually we know gold will run out. So that'll help to put them into that like second tier of economies with these five civilizations. But the Persians are clearly the best economy civilization, which means they'll be the best going into Imperial Age, probably. Take a look at the other civilizations. The Turks are a bit of an odd one. They have some tricks up their sleeve, but they're not so straightforward. They get a really strong early Imperial Age with their gunpowder. They get some really strong gunpowder, Janissaries, their navy is pretty decent, although no bonuses there, and Bombard Cannon's going to be great, or Bombard Cannons. Most of these civs do get camels, I think all of them get camels, actually. So they do get that, and their cavalry is decent, but certainly no paladins for them. So the Turks are a bit of an odd one. And remember, Not Tyrant could have chosen other civilizations. Pal going straight for Mamelukes, and this is why I think the Saracens are so good. I don't know why they were the last pick. Most of these civilizations are cavalry civilizations, and what's the best counter to cavalry? Mamelukes are the best counter to cavalry. So I love this pick by Pal. And just don't understand why other players aren't valuing the Saracens in this matchup, for their unique unit, or for the extra HP on their camels. They're going to be a force to be reckoned with this game, I think. And already Pow showing it with his early Mameluke raids. Now, the first player he's gone after is Not Tyrant, Not the Viper, who's gotten his free Hussar upgrade. Now, that's not going to do anything against the Saracens. Looks like Not Tyrant went for that fast early Imperial Age. And he's still making stables. Who is he going to target? He's got to take out someone. You don't go early Imp with no economy not to take out someone. Now, we have Development playing as the Byzantines. Who else was playing as the Byzantines? Nope. Nope, definitely not you. And Leo playing as the Byzantines. The Byzantines are a very versatile civilization. They get really good trash in the late game if gold runs out. So they get halbs, they get skirmishes really easy. The Cataphract doesn't take bonus damage from camels, which all these civilizations get camels, and they won't take bonus damage from Mamelukes. So Cataphracts will be decent against Mamelukes. So they get a good unique unit. They get good late game trash. They also get Arbalest, which most of these civs do not get. And they have a pretty decent navy, a really good navy actually with those fire ships. So they're a bit of a jack of all trades, and then a little bit extra, I think. So I do like the Byzantines in this matchup. We talked a little bit briefly about the Persians. Best economy in this game. War Elephants might be super strong against a civ that's not the Saracens. The Mamelukes will shred through elephants, I think. Normal camels don't do too well against elite War Elephants, though. And Persians will definitely get a lot of mileage out of those since they don't cost that much gold for what you get. So that could be really strong. Aside from that, I think the Persians get the best heavy cavalry in the game out of these civilizations with the Paladin upgrade. But again, all these civilizations do get camels, so you have to think about that. And then the last civilization, the Berbers. The Berbers will have some of the better camels in this game. They will be cheaper, and they will regenerate. And also, the Berbers will have some of the best navy in this game with extra movement speed, which is a big deal on things like fire ships. So I think the strength of the Berbers is definitely going to be in their camels. Let's see if Sean decides to go down that route and with their navy. So we're seeing the team in the north versus the team in the south. We have Leo EK and Not Tyrant, Not the Viper going against Development and Pow. Pow's very strong. He's able to defend himself, but unfortunately Development doesn't look so strong. And here comes the Hussar Raids. What kind of defense is Development going to put up? And I already know the answer to this question. The answer is he doesn't have a defense to put up. Development's either going to have to run to one of his allies, or he's going to have to die, or he's going to have to defend himself. And he's got two barracks up. He's got a little bit of gunpowder. He's going into those cheap halves. Perfect. But Not Tyrant already has Janissaries. Someone's saying, go Toplo, go Toplo. Yeah, Toplo's got Siege Rams out. And he's got Cavalier too. But look at Development's economy. It's all idle. How is he going to make halves without an economy? And even if he does, he's got these Janissaries to deal with. Development needs to call upon the help of his allies. Let's check who Toplo's allies are. Now, why would you want to help Development? Development. Let's check Development. Why would you want to help Development when he hasn't done anything for you this game? Because players always... You always want a trade partner. Trade partner is going to be huge in this game. And Development has tons of resources. He needs to drop down a shit ton of barracks. Look at that. 7k wood in the bank. Meanwhile, Not Tyrant's actually spent it on army, which is why he's dominating at this point. Here we go. No, tons of archery ranges, actually. Not even barracks. Yeah, probably a better choice against Janissaries. Might want to go Arbalest. I think that would be the best choice. Arbalest, maybe bombard cannons of your own, and a few light cavalry. We'll check back on him, see if he survives. Here's the elite Mamelukes from Pau going against the camels of the Byzantines. The Byzantine camels pretty good. They're cheaper. But they're not going to hold anything up to the Mamelukes. The Mamelukes are ranged. Here comes the Mamelukes. They're going to shred right through the camels. Leo EK needs a little bit of help here. Now, the help's not going to come from Toplo. Toplo is allied with the team in the south. And if anything, it's going to come from Not Tyrant. Not Tyrant needs to send his Janissaries to help deal with these Mamelukes. What's one of the best counters to Mamelukes? They're one of the strongest unique units in the game. One of the best counters to Mamelukes is probably going to be Siege. And unfortunately, the Byzantines don't get really great Siege. I'm talking like Siege Onager. In fact, none of these civilizations get Siege Onager. Oh, here's the War Elephants from Street Fighter. We're seeing, whoa, Ballerina versus Ballerina action. Look at this. This is going to come down to who has more. Both these players were thinking the same thing when they picked Persian. They're thinking, I want to go War Elephants. And how can you blame them? We're seeing the halves being mixed in from Toplo, but I like the hand... Ooh, do I like the hand cannons better? I don't know. Now, halves do plus 60 bonus damage against War Elephants, which is huge. What I would like to see from these guys is monks. Monks are going to be so efficient at taking down these elephants. We'll check back on him in a little bit. Sean is gathering a relic or two and taking complete control over the bottom, where he'll have extra resources to gear him up for that late game. Currently, lowest score is Leo at this point. He's going in for another push with his heavy camels. Let's see if he's going to be able to get it. Here comes that might of the Saracens. Siege Onager, I was wrong. Saracens are the only... our only civilization here with access to Siege Onager. Which, honestly, against these civilizations won't be too useful. All these civilizations are kind of cavalry heavy. Here's those Onagers from Leo EK. Let's see what they can do. Gonna miss a few shots. Gonna see staggered formation, and Onagers are down. Not worth it. Not worth it for Leo. And Leo's gonna... What is he gonna do to defend this? Few cataphracts out from development, not well upgraded at all. And he's trying his best just to hold out for a little bit. So Toplu's not going to come to the rescue of any of these players. Sean is here too. Remember, Sean allied with these guys. So Sean is just going to put the nail in the coffin. If you thought that Leo could defend for the time being, well, he's not going to defend very much longer. Now the thing is, Leo's going to get taken out, and that's going to leave... And development's going to get taken out. So that will leave Not Tyrant, Not the Viper, versus what looks to be Pow and Sean. Here comes those Hussars. Looks like the half choice is working out pretty well. Look at how many elephants going down. So many elephants going down. The hand cannon's just not firing in the back. They're getting so many kills on these. Oh my god. What a waste for Street Pete. Street Pete. Now the classic deathmatch Persian's combo is actually going to be War Elephant plus Scorpion. I wonder if Street Pete knows about this Heavy Scorpions. But Heavy Scorpions would do a much better job than these hand cannons. Because for the house have get a few hits in before the hand cannons even fire a bullet. If you get the Scorpions in the back, the Scorpion Bolt can pass through units, so you could potentially fire a Scorpion Bolt and hit a Howl, but before it even does any damage versus the Elephant. Yes. Street Pete saying we need to pass. Toplo saying, are we cool? Are we cool, bro? No, you're not cool. Looks like Toplo knows about that Heavy Scorpion, but the Heavy Scorpions... They'll do okay against the Elephants. They get an attack bonus. But, yeah, we need to see a lot more Howls for this to work out. Here comes Pow. Pow's going to start the battle against Not Tyrant, Not the Viper. We have two players basically out of this game. They're still alive, though. They can rebuild. But two players basically out of this game. Toplo's going to try to hold for now. And either it's going to be Not Tyrant, Not the Viper, or Sean and Pow that go down. Gonna be one or the other. Sean's got some camel archers and genitors. Not the first unit I would think of to go with as the Berbers. But again, lack of siege energy here. Gonna hurt. So those camel archers should be able to do some work. What is this? What is this on this island? What? A market and a university. Looks like... Who's gonna call it GG? Leo Nunes is going to call it GG. Down he goes. He's not going to try to rebuild. He's just going to leave his markets up. Okay, someone wants to trade with his defeated civilization. So first player out of this game is going to be Leo Nunes, the Byzantine. So far, it looks like Toplo's prevented a lot of damage. I mean, he's getting raided pretty hard. He doesn't have that much economy. Yeah, Toplo's not looking that great. Here comes the camel archers. They're going to get right next to these war elephants. That's not what you want to do. You want to micro these guys. And Cheetator is not going to do anything against these elephants. Street Pete really looking like a champion here. 2300 score for him. What's up, Dr. Slow? Welcome to the stream. How could I miss that? This is the more interesting matchup, though. We have Not Tyrant here. Was Not Tyrant... Who is he allied with? Not Tyrant is allied with Street Pete. And with Leonidas, who went down. That is really strong. I feel like these guys may be the strongest players here. Not Tyrant and Street Pete. Street Pete's clearly winning. Not Tyrant is losing, though. Definitely losing. And oh my god, here comes the Siege Honors. That's going to change everything. For Not Tyrant. Castle's going down. Hussars are running a bit, but doesn't matter. They cost food. That's all they cost. Camels coming in for Sean. This is what I liked about the Berbers. Make those cheap camels that regenerate also. And let's see how they do against these elephants. I guess if you have enough of them, they work. They work okay. They're not doing that great, I have to say. But they're definitely much cheaper, much better as far as cost efficiency. Look at this Hussar raid's coming in from Not Tyrant. He's going to try to hit back. But he needs to defend on the front for now. DC Dram's going to go down. Pal not paying attention to his land. Man, Luke's, oh my god. He's going to lose so many. Okay, he's going to go back down. And Not Tyrant looks to be pushing out. Here it comes with his rams. Here it comes with his Janissaries. The ram's going to soak up all the skirmisher bolts. And at the same time, Not Tyrant also going for those Hussar raids. So it looks like we're just seeing two teams at this point. We have Toplo, Sean, and Pow versus Not Tyrant and Street Pete. However, don't forget about Development. Where's Development's alliances lie? Maybe Development can swing the tides of the battle. Development is currently allied with Sean and Pow. Well, Toplo, what are you doing? What is Toplo doing? Toplo looks to be doing fine. Maybe he's patrolling his halbs wrong, I don't know. No, he looks to be doing fine. He's got a lot of halbs out. He survived. He didn't get raided to death like I thought he would be. And yeah, Street Pete's pushed back for now. Good news for his team, though, is Not Tyrant is pushing out. Oh my gosh, because... No, not going to see a big siege shot. Not going to see it. Yeah, Not Tyrant's really playing a pretty good game so far. On the bottom, though, might want to be careful of Development. Development's sneakily building houses along the shoreline. And he's just fishing away. That's the majority of his economy. He's a fishing economy. That's what he is. Maybe you should rebuild in Sean's base. Look at the destruction. Look at the destruction in this battlefield. Pow just can't get any momentum against these Janissaries. The key here, you're going to want camels or Mamelukes in front and then have the Siege Onagers in the back. The camels will take out the Hussars and then the Siege Onagers will get a few good shots off on the Janissaries. What we need to see from Pow is we need to see a mass army. Just retreat a little bit, start the mass army in the back, next to these castles maybe of Sean. But that's not what we're seeing him doing. He's sending units one at a time, small squadron of elite skirmishers. Progress is very slow on the top side. Oh no! How eating up those elephants, poor elephants. But this is such a strong combined force. Here come the trebuchets from Sean. Weapons of mass destruction. They'll start to work on that castle. Meanwhile, Street Pete is doing what he should do, though. He's rebuilding, he's remassing his army, which is good for him. Now, let's take a look at trade. We see trade conks from Sean. One interesting thing about the Berber's bonus, the trade cogs are actually moving faster. And they were already, trade cogs were already buffed in the recent expansion. So this can be fairly effective, I feel. And currently, it looks like Sean's the only one with trade up at this point. All the other players probably going to run low on gold relatively shortly. Running low on gold means no more hand cannons, no more bombard cannons, very few elephants. And that's definitely going to give an advantage to Topple, who's made a lot of halves, or the Berbers, who has access to Genitors. So many halves, they're even overwhelming these hand cannons. Oh my god. Hand cannon's supposed to be the counter to the halves. They're not supposed to be overwhelmed like this. Look at the stream for Not Tyrant, though. Look at that. He needs more rams, though. You gotta clean this up quickly. Once you have the momentum, you don't want to lose it. Playing a game with 3 roots minus a board with my allies as noob. Came to cheer me up. I'll try my best, slow roll. I'll try my best. Every player's going to Heavy Scorpions. Apparently Heavy Scorpions is the thing that's in style right now. So Sean is going to come to the aid of Pal. As you can see, Sean brought his army from the north. You can see it on the mini-map. But at the same time, that's going to leave Street Pete an opportunity to push back and take down a castle. Let's see if this combined force. This combined force looks to be enough to push back Not Tyrant, Not the Viper. Let's see if Street P can do the damage now. It's up to him. What would be smart from Street P is to add him to some skirmishers to give him a non-gold unit that counters halves. Let's take a look at his resources. Currently no gold for him. It's really important he adds skirmishers. And he's popcapped at 250. Player's gonna call GG. Who's calling GG? I think it's Not Tyrant's gonna call GG. He's lost most of his army. He doesn't think he can win 2v1, is that it? Let's see the GG coming in. Yes, no, yes, no. Here comes the Hussars. The Hussars gonna go to the economy. Okay, I don't know who called GG. Whoever called GG is not gonna resign. Oh my god. Oh my god. Ridiculous battlefield. Where are the Hussars going? where are these guys going? You're just gonna put 200 Hussars in the same place. It's coming with villagers too. Okay. What is this? Looks like this this choke point, this battle in the choke point's not going anywhere soon. It's funny, none of the players want to go through this choke point. Gotta be this one here. What are all these villages for too? So these guys are gonna push back Not Tyrant some more. Let's check out development. What has development done in the last, what, half hour? He's got 2 transport ships. He's got some villages moving around on the north. Not allied with Not Tyrant. I think development's just waiting for Not Tyrant, Not the Viper's place to get cleared out, and then he'll have a space for real estate for him to set up shop. Oh, here we go. He's going to rebuild his economy here. Let's go to Not Tyrant's point of view. It's gonna be at 250 pop cap now. However, he's losing a lot of economy in his base. He's losing a lot of villagers. He has no more food in the bank. Let's see what he does with these Hussar. This is an absolute mess. Here he goes. He's gonna send one group of Hussar out. What about the rest? Okay, second group of Hussar out. What is development doing? His pilgrims. His pilgrims are gonna land in the absolute worst place you could possibly land. I hope not Tyrant sees this. Look at, what are these pilgrims gotta be thinking? What are these guys thinking? Yeah, let's land right here, right next to the army of Not Tyrant. Alright, Development's gonna get back in his ships. Yeah, and get the hell out of there. Only losing 2-3 villagers. Dumb ship, dumb sailor. Now, Not Tyrant's gonna focus on a single person. Who's he gonna go after? Yeah, this is it for Not Tyrant. He doesn't have any economy left. He's gonna go after Pal. He's gonna try to give it everything he's got to defeating his arch rival here. Maybe this is just a sign of intimidation. Maybe Pal's gonna think, oh, there's so many Hustler in my base. What can I do about that? I gotta resign. Probably not gonna happen though, because look at Not Tyrant's economy. I don't think this was worth it from his point of view at all. As usual, nothing's happened over in the top side. If anything, it looks like players have given up. Please demos. Please demos for the Hustlers. Nah, they're just trade cogs. Meanwhile, Not Tyrant has dropped down to 120 population. And he is not going to get back up. Or is he? He is going to put his villagers into this bombard tower? What was the point of this? It's a lovely tower. I mean, it overlooks the Bay Area. But I don't know what the point of it is. So here's what's left of the Hustlers. As we can see, Pal is the second player. I think it's pretty fair to say the second player to set up trade. There's only two players in this game that are trading. Which is very important. Very important. And Sean has got to have at least 10,000 gold from this trade. Take a look. He's got tons of resources stockpiled up, so he's had a very good game so far. He's got a lot of land in the south. He's got a lot of... Look at how much land he has in the middle, too. How much control he has. And look at his banked resources, too. So if I'm going to pick anyone to win this game, I'm probably going to pick Sean at this point. Now, of course, we still have Pal. Pal has shown he's been a force to be reckoned with. He's going to get access to gold, which means he can create a lot more siege onagers and Mamelukes. I don't know how the Berbers will deal with that. Not Tyrant's going to say GG again. I think this is going to be the real one. Yeah, there we go. There's the real GG from Not Tyrant. Still a higher score than Development, though. So that's it. We're down to 5 players now. What is this saying? Saracen's still probably got to be have the best army, especially against Berbers. Really against all these civilizations. I don't think there's a civilization here that will beat Saracen's late game. Ideally. Streambeat's also going to call it GG. He's getting pushed now. Not Terry's gone out. He's not a distraction anymore for Pal. So Pal's going to come in here. I think that's going to be enough for Streambeat to call it. He's resigned already. He's seen that. He's seen the elite Mamelukes. He's seen the siege onagers of Pal. And now everyone is allied at the stage. We have the Middle Eastern team GGing it out. Who's going to be the first player to turn on each other? Sean is saying you want to duke it out. Sean is sitting at 20k gold. Let's check Pal's gold. Pal is sitting at 5k gold, which is respectable. Now, this is important how this goes. So 4 players left. Development's not a threat. I wouldn't worry about Development. What is nice is Toplo and Sean are currently trading, which is not something I would want to stop, but Sean is also trading with Pal. So we'll see who has to turn on each other first. Let's go for the point of view of each player. So if I'm Sean, I want to be buddy buddies with Pal because I'm trading from their dock. So that's what I would want. If I was Toplo, I would want to be buddies with Sean, because I'm trading with him with the carts. So everyone wants to be buddies with Sean. It would make the most sense, therefore, for Pow and Toplo to battle. Oh, a player's gonna build a wonder. Who's building the wonder? Pow is building a wonder. Pow is in a very weird position to build a wonder. He's in the middle of the map. Now, if Sean built a wonder... Oh, Sean's gonna build a wonder here. That's a perfect position for a wonder. Let's see who gets this wonder up first. What is Toplo gonna do? Toplo, you better start a wonder too. There's no harm in starting the latest wonder. Really no harm at all. Here we go. Here's the wonder race. Pal is going to bring some more in. It looks like Sean's going to get his wonder up first, though. He's clearly got more villagers here. It'd be worth it even to build more villagers. This is why you hate Diplo Street, Pete. This was a good game, though. This is good. Alright, so Toplo and Pow, Sean and Pow are going to be the only players to build their wonders. 28%, basically 30% for Pow. 40% for Sean. Sean is going to get his up first. And Toplo's going to build his last. So we know Pow and Toplo have to go to war. Toplo depends on who's going to win that war. If Pow wins that war, then Toplo can hang back and try to attack Pow a little bit later on. If Pow is not winning the war against... Pow's not winning the war against Sean, then Toplo has to help out. And fight Sean and hopefully have enough time to also fight Pow. What does development do? Who knows? Who knows what development does? Here's his economy now. Still working to rebuild. Now, how is this going to affect trade relations? I have no idea. So there we go. Sean's going to be the first up. There's his lovely Berber wonder. Would be very important for Sean to wall at this stage and maybe build a lot of galleys. In fact, look at Sean's map. He could just wall here. He could just maybe triple, quadruple, I don't know, 20 layers of wall just here, and then build a really huge galleon navy along the coast. And I think that would ensure him a victory. We'll have to see what these players do. But Pow doesn't have a great position for defending his wonder. He has a lot of castles. There we go. Pow's going to go water. Now, honestly, I think the Saracens have a stronger navy. Their galleons will attack faster. Whereas the Berbers just move faster. Not a big deal. And Topple's going to be a while with his wonder. Will development help this effort? Development, the only big military we've seen from him has been on the water. So Pow is running against the clock. What Pow needs is a bit of gold. Does he have gold? He has a bit of gold. He's got lovely Saracen transports if he wants to transport over. That's the first thing he's got. Although he needs to get the transport upgrades. The Saracen transport, if you didn't know, double HP plus 5 carry capacity. It's one of those bonuses you never see use of. And there we go. Dry dock going to be researched. Going to give them 25 carrying capacity. Now, none of the trade has gotten taken out yet. In fact, I don't even think players have turned on each other. They're going to wait till the last second. So, 300 years remaining. This started at 350 to give you a bit of reference point. I tell you what, I think we're going to see a wonder by the time one of these wonders comes down, though. And certainly with Toplo's wonder, too. So this game is going to be coming to a close pretty shortly. We're going to see hopefully an intense action-packed finale. We saw Street Pete going out, Not Tyrant, Not the Viper, some really strong players. Leo went out early. And what does this say as far as the civilizations? We have Berbers left. Saracens left, a Persians left, and a Byzantines left. So one of every civilization is still alive, which is interesting. Sean's saying, so anyone going to do anything? Yeah, Pao is certainly taking his time. And there you go, third wonder up. Toplo's got a huge army. Now, if Toplo attacks Pao right now, game over, because Sean's going to win it. So Toplo better be pretty smart. He better not pull a Toplo, let's put it that way, and defeat himself. Will Toplo pull a Toplo? What? No! What the fuck? How did Pao do that? Are you kidding me? Sean, what are you doing, Sean? Sean, do something about this. Oh my god, what a... Look at this. Pao's not going to go for the epic invasion. He's going to defend his wonder, and will he be able to get it with a few siege rams? What kind of play is this? Has Sean even noticed? He must have noticed. He must have noticed the siege workshops. What are you doing, Sean? How do you let this happen? This is only what you get in diplomacy. Diplomacy standard victory. There we go, bit of action. Looks like Toplo's gonna take out the trade. I bet money on you. Oh, development is just staying in the game because he bet on this game. He wants to shape the income of this, outcome of this game so he gets to get his sheep back. If you're on YouTube, sheep is the currency for my Twitch channel. Which, by the way, you should join. You should join the Twitch channel. It's a lot of fun. A lot more fun when you see the games live. Get to bet on the games as well. Play a lot of fun mini games. And talk to the Age of Empires community. This is... What the hell is this? Okay. There's no suspense in this at all. Like, Pao's gonna destroy this wonder 100%. Thanks a lot, Pao. If he does that, that's gonna leave us with the... This is smart, though. This is smart for him to wait. Pao should wait to the absolute last second. That way, keeps Toplo preoccupied. Toplo is thinking... Toplo doesn't know that Pao is over here and can destroy this wonder whatever he likes. It's just buying time for Pao. Toplo wastes his halves. Alright, 210 years remaining for Pao. Has yellow? He must have noticed. He was building walls, he was building stables. Maybe he thinks... I understand if you look at the minimap, you might think that's trade or something. But there's just no way to stop this. Unless Sean brings all of his stuff in right now. Get some rams of his own and take down the siege workshops. What is development doing, though? This is a smart play from Pao, though. This is such a smart play. Waiting until the last second to turn. In fact, actually, yeah, it definitely has to turn. Come on, Pao. Just if you're Pao, just keep making siege rams. Just make them until all these. Just keep un-garrisoning them. Just make a million siege rams in this area. Your Toplo, what? How are you gonna get through these walls of your Toplo? You're not gonna get through those walls with halves. What were you thinking, Toplo, going in with only halves and no siege? Okay, here comes his villages for the siege. Show wall the siege. That's the thing about siege, they're good at taking out walls. I mean, if somehow you could get them 100% walled, then okay. What's Tao doing? It's probably smart for Pal just to sacrifice all his villages so he can get more army out. That's what I'm thinking. I'm wanting to not lose. I wonder who did development bet on? What is going on here? Ass suicide. But three are gonna make it, wow. They haven't even seen- look, they're not even looking at that all their friends died. Oh, there we go, I'm hearing attack bills. Okay, and Pal's gonna take out that wonder instantaneously. What is Sean's reaction? 153 years remaining. Now, what were you thinking, Sean? What were you thinking? Alright, so we have 150 years. We're gonna have a 2v1 against Pal for 150 years. Tapu's regrouping his army. He's got a lot of bomber cannon set up. Should be coming back with the majority of his army now. Gonna lose a lot here. Here's Sean's army, so. We have Sean's army in the north. We have Tapu's army in the left. I would go in now. 200 years is not a lot of time. Tapu's mobilizing. And they don't have to get very far to get through this wonder. This is one of the weaknesses of Pal. He's built his wonder basically in the middle of nowhere. It's not against the edge of the map. There's no stone walls around it. And there's not a lot of stuff to get in the way of this wonder. It's just kind of there. You should pick your wonder locations very wisely. Imagine building a wonder here. Imagine how great that would be. Or on this little island. Nah, too small. The biggest threat to Sean is going to be those trebuchets, though. And bumper cannons, here they go. They can even try a quick snipe with that many. All right, here comes the meat shield. These guys are going to trade castles. Here's the big army for Sean. And here we go. Bumper cannons are exposed. Here comes the siege onagers. Oh my god. Oh my god, Tapu. Two bombard cannons down. Alright, most of them get out of there. Here comes the Mamelukes. Mamelukes can take down some of these skirmishers. This army's super strong from Pal, but can he deal with this army of Sean? And Sean, why the hell do you not rebuild your wonder? You're just wasting time. Oh my god, huge siege shots. That's not how that should have gone down. The bomber cannons need to be on the onagers. Oh my god, another huge shot. Oh my god! Jesus. That was ridiculous. 150 years. No. 90 years. 90 years for Pal. Topless first wave getting defeated. Here comes the second wave. This is going to be close. Yeah, now it's defend the wonder. Defend the wonder, we didn't know that would be this. What is development doing? Development's going against Pal. Let's see how much he can do. The wonder is not within range of these cannon gallons, however, can take down two castles. It's all up to these siege onagers. The siege onagers is going to be key here. Two siege onagers is going to go down. Four siege onagers is going to go down. We have two siege onagers remaining. No, three. Here comes second wave from Tapu. Can Tapu focus down the siege onagers? That's the only thing he needs to focus. One of them down. Pal's gonna run out. Oh my god. Can he hold on for 67 more years? No, castle's gonna go down. The Mamelukes have to fight. They have to fight. Or snipe off the bomber cannons or something. Sean's gonna go straight for the wonder. Here he goes. No, he's gonna focus on the Onager. He goes, he could have shot at the Wonder. Oh, it doesn't matter. Toplin's gonna get the Wonder. No! Where is he? Yes, here he is. Down goes the Wonder Pow. Second Wonder destruction of his game. Everything's gonna change right now. Everything needs to change right now. These guys have to stop fighting each other and now go against Toplin. Toplin's gonna run. He's gonna run with his army. He wants to get back, get into position. And these guys haven't realized it yet. Why are they still fighting? Why are these guys still fighting? Toplin's gonna win this game in 100 years. What is... Toplin hasn't learned his lesson from Pow, though. Toplin needs to build defenses. He needs to build... Just build a million lumber camps here or something to block a path off. What does Toplin's resources look like? No gold, no stone, no wood. Nice. Wood is actually kind of low in this game. Actually, there... Scratch that. There is no wood in this game. There literally is no wood in this game. So this game might literally be a draw if Toplin doesn't win it right here. Like, I'm dead serious. Like, this game could literally be a draw if Toplin doesn't win this game. Wonder what I think of this game. What I think right now is I hope to God, I hope to whatever, that Toplin wins this game. Now, if he doesn't win this game right now, Sean is by default the winner. Look at his resources. So we're going to have a winner here, whether it's going to be Sean through his resources or it's going to be Toplin through his wonder. Now this is just a 1v1 at the stage. A Pow is out of this game. This is a 1v1 between Sean and Toplin. Not even a 1v1, it's a 1v1 that Sean has to win in 70 years or he loses. This is going to come down to the wire. Or development wins this game. That's going to be the comeback of the century. Development's got a lot of food in the bank. A lot of food. And a relic. But he's not out. Oh, no! I think development bet on Toplin. That's the only explanation for this. Development must have bet on Toplin, so he's going to build some stone walls. He can get a lot up if he buys some stone with his food. Can they hold, though, 58 years? Here's the meat shield. This is all or nothing for Toplin. Alright, Sean's taking his time. He's going to take down the two castles first. He's going to clear this out. 50 more years. Toplin will win in 50 more years. Oh, it's a little premature. The village is going to soak up the shots while the Halb's coming. If these camel arches go down, that might be it. That's GG if these camel arches go down. Will they go down, though? Here comes the Halbs. Here comes the elephants. The elephants will tank. Will the elephants tank enough, though? Here comes the skirmishers from Sean. They can take out these Halbs. Camel arches going down. Sean's got more in the back, though. Sean's got tons of resources. All right, Toplin's got to get back for now. Got to use those bombard cannons against the skirmishers. 34 years, this is going to be so close. Sean just needs to get to that wonder. He's got the army. He has the army. Pow is in the north. Oh, Pow is coming in the north. You're right. Bombard cannons are in position. 27 years. This is as intense as it gets. Oh my god, they're going to get through those. Persians only get stone walls. That could be game deciding. Okay. No! Pow's gonna lose his siege. Does one get in? Does one get in? Not even one! Oh my god, nice try, Pow. But here comes Sean! 17 years! It's all up to these bombard cannons. In fact, send out these Halbs development. Send out the Halbs if you want Toplin to win. So you can get your bet. Go Toplin! Oh, 10 years left! Can you take down a wonder in 10 years? What are you doing, Sean? You have enough bombard cannons. You have the army. 8 years! 8 years, Sean. What are you doing? Here he comes. 5 years. Four. This is gonna be close. They're gonna fire. 2-1. We're gonna see 0-0. And Topla's gonna win this game. Wow. What an epic game. After two wonder destructions, all those alliances, all those resources that Sean had in the bank. Look at that. Oh my gosh. After everything said and done, we'll have Toplo, the Persian player, win this game through a wonder victory. Wow, what an epic game. What a great game. This is one of the best Turbo Diplo I have seen. Wow. If you haven't seen my previous Turbo Diplo, please click the link here. The Master Diplomat was quite a good game. And hopefully, I'll see you in the next game.